man who has a view for all seasons, your host, Stan Weisleder.
Okay, it's time for you people to wake up. You are listening to The View from Over Here, which is heard on CRN Digital Talk Radio and carried on the World Wide Web at crntalk.com. I'm in the studio today with Malcolm Berman and two of our special guests, Robert Hooks and Lori Marlowe, who will be talking to us about the entertainment industry and what they had to put up to get to where they are today. But first, we have the news for the week.
We need the drum roll.
Drum roll.
I don't have a drum
roll. Paul, wake up. What's this guy doing in the control room?
Very good.
That's a drum roll.
It's a low-budget show.
Remind me not to hire him to be in our band. Hey, are the freeways getting too crowded for you? Nobody shows you any respect anymore? Some smartass cuts you off and gives you the finger? Well, I have the answer to your problems. For $200,000 to $250,000, you can get your own M37 howitzer tank. The only drawback is that it has a top speed of 35 miles per hour.
That's all you can go on the freeway anyway.
But once they get a glimpse of your 105-millimeter cannon and your top-mounted 50-caliber machine gun, no one will dare to mess with you. In fact, they'll all give you the right of way. I guarantee it. Now, the government is finally getting after those Medicare doctors that are ripping off the system as well as the public. And I wrote about this in my article on the Affordable Care Act, otherwise known as Obamacare. Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon, move over. This summer, the U.S. Navy will be installing laser weaponry on some of its warships. So watch out, Malcolm. They get you that way.
I thought they had it already.
In the experimental stage. Now they're being installed for actual usage in the field. What better way to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Ford Mustang? It's 50 years old now. And they're doing it on top of the deck of the observation deck of the Empire State Building.
I hate to say, I remember when the Ford Mustang came out that first year, because I rented one.
You rented one.
I couldn't afford it, but I rented one.
They have one now on the observation deck of the Empire State Building. And you know how they got it up there? Piece by piece on the elevator, and then they assembled it once they got all the parts up there, just like Humpty Dumpty.
They didn't have a driveway to drive it up?
Nope, they don't. They don't, no driveway.
I can picture this big ramp going from, you know, 42nd Street.
They don't have it.
And going up a circular, right.
Don't have it. Hey, you ever thought about, is there life out there?
I thought about, is there life down here? I'm not sure about that.
Down here, no. Out there, maybe. Anyway, the scientist Kepler-186f, that's the designation for an Earth-like planet that lies within its own Goldilocks zone of its own sun, which is about, well, depending on what scientist you talk to, one says 459 light-years away, and the other one says 500 light years away.
Yeah,
either way, by cosmic distances, it's a hop, skip, and a jump.
Right nearby.
Right, so is there life out there? Maybe, well, here, like you said.
Well, I can't understand how. Why does life as we know it needs oxygen and everything that we have, but why can't there be another form? Maybe it's not life, but another form of existence.
Maybe there
that,
is.
That doesn't need oxygen.
And it may be life today.
And it doesn't need
life.
Water. Do me a favor, guys. Stand closer to the... you can bring it over if you want, the mic.
Speaking of water, when we go to a restaurant and they put down water in front of me, I never drink water. The only time I drink water is in a Chinese restaurant. But other than that, I never drink water in a regular restaurant.
Well, do you know what W.C. Field said about it? Drink water, fish piss in it.
Malcolm, come on.
I'm just quoting W.C. Fields.
Okay. All right, last item of the news for the week. And this is really hot stuff. I just picked this up, and I mentioned it to somebody else, and they said, yeah, they heard about it. During the Winter Olympics that took place in Sochi, okay, the Olympic Committee officials, they distributed 100,000 condoms to 7,650 athletes, okay? And in deference to Paul, I'm not going to use the word, but that amounts to an average of 13.072 bleeps per athlete. Okay? Paul, okay, you didn't have to catch that. Okay, I didn't use the other word.
Okay. What was the other word?
Never mind.
No, I can't. He bleeped me on it last week. So my question is to the Olympic Committee, did they take into account all of the different sexes? Now, mind you, I didn't say both sexes. I said all of the different sexes. And did they take age into account? And how long they would be there? So in other words, 13.072 bleeps per athlete. How many is that per week or per day or per sex or what?
I think it's very optimistic. But they're athletes.
Isn't it great to be young?
And athletic.
And athletic.
Well, it used to be, I remember when I played ball, they said, don't have sex before a game.
Yeah, why?
Because supposedly it drained your energy. But now I hear the recommendation is, do it.
Because you might not be able to afterwards because of injuries.
It gets you primed for the game.
Yeah, I can never understand why it would make any difference. If anything, it would get you more crazy, more hyped up.
Well, I think everyone should do it before they do a show. It makes them more aware.
Malcolm, enough of that. Let's introduce our guest before we have one of those rude commercial interludes by Paul in the control room. Now he's laughing. He thinks it's funny. Okay, we have Robert Hooks and Lori Marlowe with us today, and they've been in the entertainment field for a number of years now. And what say you, Robert?
Well, I say, first of all, thank you very much for having Lori and I on the show. I'm going to take these ears. Thank you very much for having us on the show. We heard about your wonderful dulcet tones on the air, so we decided.
In other words,
why
I
not?
Didn't put you to sleep. Good. Okay.
But no, it's nice to be here. We're anxious to get into our own show and talk about the entertainment industry. We do opinions, we do commentary, and we talk generally about everything that's happening in the industry, the entertainment industry. And we just don't talk about what's happening with blacks in the industry, but we talk about what's happening in the industry with everyone. So it's happy, I'm glad to be here, and certainly my wife is one of the experts. So
well, before you two experts get on, let me just give you a quick overview of, let's say, where I or most people come from, because we have no clue as to what you went through to get to where you are, okay? But thinking back many years ago, the only thing that I would remember is all black parts were played by Sidney Poitier, okay? And if he was a song and dance man, they were all played by Sammy Davis Jr., okay? And that's what the public saw, okay? I know you were there because I remember seeing you on TV a gazillion times and also in movies, but the public is not aware. So go for it.
Well, no. I mean, the history of blacks in the entertainment industry is a long and sometimes dreary and negative one. But look, we've come a long way. We still have a lot of things to correct that are wrong in the industry as it relates to work for actors in the industry, opportunities for writers to write in the industry, for producers to produce, and for owners to own in the industry. So that's still a problem that we have to deal with, and that's some of the things that we'll be dealing with in our show. But no, we've come a long way, and yes, it was a gazillion years ago when I was on television. Sidney Poitier was one of my favorite people, and that's how really I made the decision to be serious and get into the entertainment industry and become an actor was because I saw Sidney Poitier, and that was it. That's all it took for me to see Sidney. But I want to introduce Laurie, because Laurie and I go back. I met Laurie when Laurie was 19 years old. And
that was, what, 5 years ago?
Oh, I don't know. It seems like seven. I don't know.
But we've known each other. But we actually did not get together for many, many years after that. And this was back in New York. So we both have been in the industry for that long. So, Laurie, what say you, my dear?
Well, actually, I wanted to speak a bit more about the perspective that we have to offer with Entertainment Matters, which is a play on matters dealing with entertainment, but also the fact that entertainment and the arts matter. One of the things that I think distinguishes Robert's career, and the thing that justifies our working currently on his memoirs, More Than Myself, at the Crossroads of Arts, Politics, Culture, and the Civil Rights Movement.
Excuse me for a minute. Do me a favor, yeah. Laurie. When you talk to Robert, speak into the mic also, because you have a tendency of looking
just
away.
Just make pretend I'm the mic.
Right.
And you're kissing me.
Oh, well, this is going to lead to a whole other show.
Well, you're an actress. we'll turn off the cameras. And
you know, and so I think that that's one of the perspectives, one of the important perspectives that Robert and this show bring to the station, that, yes, he was inspired by A Raisin in the Sun and seeing this extraordinary cast of actors led by Sidney Poitier to think that perhaps there would be jobs in the future, material in the future, but he then created three huge arts organizations, most notably the Negro Ensemble Company in New York in the 60s, which led to the careers of many people that, you know, that are second nature. Denzel Washington,
Samuel L. Jackson,
Lawrence Fishburne,
Roscoe Lee Brown,
and that's not just in front of the camera.
I've heard of some of those guys.
You know, and so the Negro Ensemble Company was kind of it created material that was a precursor to August Wilson. Suddenly, there was a body of work, books and books written on those plays, and so, you know, Robert has been part of the evolution of isolated jobs leaking into the greater film and television industry that we're so familiar with, that we're so taken with, and he's a member of the Academy. So as award season and screening season rolls around, there will be some interesting insider perspectives talking about the voting process and some more obscure films that are being shown.
Yeah, we'll be doing a lot of that, especially come Oscar time, because I am a member of the Academy, and I've been a member for, since 50 years, perhaps.
When the Mustang came out, yeah, I remember.
Right, exactly. your Mustang story. But no, as a matter of fact, I'm going to back up for a minute and talk about Sidney Poitier for a minute, because I was studying acting in Philadelphia as a young man. I must have been, 22 years old. And I was doing plays in the acting workshop, I was working with Bruce Dern,
Bruce,
as a matter of fact.
Do me a favor,
sure.
Robert, hold that for a minute. You see, we have 60 seconds left.
Oh, okay.
So for the commercial, so hold on to the thought.
This goes longer than 60 seconds.
I know. I just want to add, did you ever see a movie called Nothing But a Man with Ivan Dixon? I think that was the first movie that I've seen that really talked about a black experience down south and what they had to go through. That was directed towards a white audience or a general audience.
Right, and there's a short story about that one, too, I'll tell.
Anyway, guys, you're listening to The View from Over Here, heard on CRN Digital Talk Radio, carried on the World Wide Web at crntalk.com, also heard on www.viewfromoverhere.com. Stay tuned, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
A Killer of Lions by Stan Weisleder. There were four squadrons of black fighter pilots during World War II that had to fight two air forces in order to gain recognition, the Luftwaffe and the U.S. Army Air Corps. The HBO special and the recent attempt at a full-length feature film do not come close to the full and true story of these brave men. They were not ball players. They were not rap singers. They were fighter pilots and American heroes in the truest sense. A Killer of Lions by Stan Weisleder.
Fact. U.S. credit card debt is 8 times larger than it was 30 years ago. No wonder you and I are feeling the credit card crunch. You're not alone. Increasing prices and the costs of credit are stretching budgets and preventing people just like us from getting ahead or just catching up with our debts. At American Financial Debt Relief, we can help. We have tested ways to help you get out of debt. Find out how now. The call is free to learn more. If you qualify, we can reduce your interest, show you how to stop your debt from getting larger, and help you get out of debt faster than you can by making minimum payments. So if you're falling behind on your credit cards or medical bills, give us a call right now, where a free 5-minute call can change your life.
800-978-4817. 800-978-4817. Reduce your credit card debt. Call now. 800-978-4817. 800-978-4817.
Hey everyone, have you heard about the No-No hair removal device that's sweeping the globe? If you want to go weeks without shaving and get smooth, professional, quality results, here's our favorite host, Cheryl, for No-No hair removal.
Thanks. Hey gals, I love talking about my No-No. It's this cute little hair removal system that you can take with you and use almost anywhere at home or on the road. No more expensive in-office treatments, painful waxing, and no more wasting your valuable time. Got unwanted facial hair? No-No has patented Thermacon technology that works on all hair and skin colors, so it's perfect for using on all body parts. And now you can take advantage of this incredible risk-free trial. Get the No-No, the facial kit, a travel case, and a $100 discount shopping card, and you don't risk a penny to try it. Try the incredible No-No hair completely risk-free. Call 1-800-953-5208. That's 800-953-5208. 800-953-5208.
Hi, this is Robert Conrad asking you to join me this year at the Memphis Film Festival, June 12th through the 14th, at Sam's Town and Gambling Hall, just south of Memphis. There will be 3 classic Western screening rooms, guest star panels, and my special question and answer session Friday night, June 13th. For full information, go to our website at memphisfilmfestival.com. Join me in June. Get the details at the memphisfilmfestival.com.
Go for it, Stan.
Go for it. Okay, thanks for the cue, Malcolm. This is Stan Weisleder at CRNTalk.com. Heard over CRN Digital Talk Radio, blah, blah, blah.
Well, before we get into
so
the
on
thing,
and so forth.
I still want people to vote whether they like this music, This Is Putting Me to Sleep, or Eine Kleine Nacht, which we had as an opening, or anything they want. Eine Kleine Nacht was her opening.
Get out of here.
The bad shows.
You hear what our guest said? Get out of here. Okay, that does it. Okay, we have 2 special guests with us today, Robert Hooks and Lori Marlowe, and they are talking to us about the entertainment business, the movie business, TV business, Broadway plays, ensembles, you name it, and particularly they're going to talk about what they had to put up to get to where they are.
You name it, and I've done
it. Okay.
Robert, I think, I don't know if I did it on air, we're talking about Nothing But a Man with Ivan Dixon.
A great movie, right, Nothing But a Man with Ivan Dixon, but there were 2 actors after all the auditions, everybody auditioned for that movie, after all the auditions were done, it was down to 2 actors to play that role. Ivan Dixon and me.
Wow.
And that's how close it was for me to get that role. And when Ivan got that role, Ivan and I became best friends because of that thing that we did for that, you know. But I met him in A Raisin in the Sun. Nothing But a Man, a great, great film with Ivan Dixon and Abby Lincoln. And I can't remember, Robert Young, I believe, directed it.
I just remember coming away with a feeling. The basic story was that Ivan Dixon was, I think, an auto mechanic.
Yes.
You know, coming from a fairly lower class existence. And Abby Lincoln was the daughter of a preacher.
Right.
And they were supposed to, I mean, they were upper class, but they always had to be good. They had to be the good black.
One of the best.
Couldn't make noise.
Right. One of the earliest and best dramatic success films in this country was nothing but a man. Yeah. And it was probably Ivan's best work as an actor.
I wonder if it's on DVD now. It would be wonderful to view it again with this passage of time.
Well, I haven't seen it, but I remember there was one scene where he gets to be, I think he goes to get this tank filled up of gas, and there's some white Southerners who start talking about his wife, you know, flirting with her and making derogatory remarks about her.
Yeah.
And he can't do anything, and you feel his face tighten up, you know, because they're threatening. You know, if it was a white guy, I mean, he'd just blow those guys away.
Sure.
But as a black man, he couldn't be uppity.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was that was the period, and that was when black stories first really came to film, and that was one of the best.
Yeah, I think the second one that I note is, I think, where your son appeared, Sounder.
Oh, Sounder,
with Paul Winfield.
Many years later, but yes, Sounder, again, one of the best dramas ever done on film. As a matter of fact, Academy Award nominated, I guess, 6 or 7 times. And a very dear friend of mine wrote that screenplay. And he actually wrote the role of Earl Lee in the film for Kevin, my son. Mm-hmm. Who is now a big-time director and doing all kinds of things in the industry, but Sounder was his first.
Kevin got to direct the remake of Sounder because he's a powerful producer director now.
And that was really ironic and very interesting bit of trivia that Kevin Hooks directed the remake of Sounder that he starred in as a kid. You know, he was like 12.
He didn't want to play the part as a father.
And Paul Winfield, who played his father, was also in that movie and was very ill at the time and immobile. He couldn't walk much. And he played the role of the teacher, which was played by Janet McLaughlin in the film.
Well, just jumping forward to another thing, the Academy Awards, they had Sidney Poitier came out, but he looked like he was either had a stroke or was out of it. He didn't seem to par. I don't know the story behind it.
Well, he's not been well. He's 85 years old or something like that. No, I think older, 87.
I think it was 87
years old. And he's not in failing health. But, you know, 87, and, you know, he's, it's not easy to get around, and I think he's suffering from some kind of vision thing. So, he finds it difficult reading.
Right, that's what I gathered,
yeah. So he had to read things off of the teleprompter.
He's starting with that music.
Okay, we're
again.
Back. Okay,
another commercial break. Don't go away. Okay. You're going to be with us the rest of the hour.
You're listening to The View from Over Here, heard on CRN Digital Talk Radio and carried on the World Wide Web at crntalk.com and heard intergalactically. I don't know if that's a word.
It is now.
I just coined it.
They heard you on Kepler 186.
It's like a selfie. Be back in a few minutes.
Something you don't hear on the radio every day, someone who can't see. I am totally blind, and I go through periods where I'm unable to sleep at night and feel like I'm constantly running but can never quite catch up. But this isn't a sleep problem. It's something called Non-24. Learn about the link between total blindness and your symptoms. Visit learnmorenon24.com or call 855-856-2424.
Sponsored by Vanda Pharmaceuticals.
Someday, there'll be a cure. Someday, we won't lose the people we love. But when is someday? Someday is today. Thanks to the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, hundreds of thousands diagnosed with blood cancer are today living a normal life. We're making cures happen. Join us. Call 888-HELP-LLS. Go to lls.org. Help us reach today sooner.
When you really want Italian food, you've got to go to Columbo's. Columbo's Italian Steakhouse and Jazz Club. Colorado Boulevard, Eagle Rock. It's the little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. It's the new year. Take command of the situation by supporting Columbo's in their drive to legalize marinara. Columbo's, designated the official Los Angeles House of Good Eats, has the most succulent steaks, the freshest catch from the seven seas, family Italian favorites, the envy of Italian mothers everywhere, and meatballs so delicious, the recipes held under lock and key in a secret vault. Just come into Columbo's, enjoy the fun, the food, the jazz every night, and then register to legalize marinara. You could win a spaghetti with marinara sauce and meatballs dinner for two from Columbo's. Drawings every month. Please your palate. Enjoy the good times at Columbo's, that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Columbo's. Mangia.
Have you ever considered adding a home security system but thought it would be too expensive? Here's the good news. There's never been a more affordable time to help protect your home, valuables, and your loved ones. You can now get a $100 Visa card from Protect Your Home, your authorized ADT dealer, with the installation of a new ADT monitored system. Here's even better news. Your new system, worth $850, is free. You pay just a $99 installation charge and purchase monthly monitoring for less than $2 a day. Call Protect Your Home today at 1-866-669-8954. That's 1-866-669-8954. Get the peace of mind that comes with owning an ADT monitored system, plus a $100 Visa card from Protect Your Home. Call now 1-866-669-8954. That's 1-866-669-8954. 36-month monitoring contract required. General terms and conditions apply. Visit protectyourhome.com/terms.
Hi, this is Fred Dreyer. Join us for the PM Show Wednesdays at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, here on CRN Digital Talk Radio. We'll discuss common sense and reason as it applies to the insanity of American politics. Once again, it's the PM Show with Fred Dreyer, Wednesdays at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio.
Okay, we're back. This is Stan Weisleder on CRN Talk, and I'm here with Malcolm Berman and our guests today, Robert Hooks and Laurie Marlowe.
I think it's from Malcolm Berman from Brooklyn.
Are you from Brooklyn?
Yeah, because there's Malcolm Berman who's an engineer from Atlanta, Georgia.
And there's a Robert Hooks who's a second story man who's in jail.
Oh, you told me that story. I have a story for you also. So impersonating me.
Really?
But wait a minute, I got another one for you. As I was telling you before we started the show, I was looking on the internet and I found the guy by the name of Robert Hook.
There's
a young white guy. He says, no, he can't be related to our guest.
Well, that's not so true, but okay.
Robert, you used to be a young white guy?
No, actually I wasn't a young white guy. I was an old black guy when I was young. No, there is another Robert Hooks, but there are several Robert Hookses. One of them, you know, one of them took me through a period in the 60s that he had just come out of jail, this one. He's a second story man, and he just posed as me and ran up bills in hotels in New York, and the hotels came after me. I'm on Broadway in my dressing room, and all of a sudden I get a call, and you know, they're after me to pay a bill that this other Robert Hooks. So I put my lawyer on him, and he took care of it. He said, I will sue you if you don't leave my client alone. So this Robert Hooks has been following me through the years.
Well, I don't know.
Well, you know what you should have done? You should have gone on and incur bills and say it's his bill. It's that Robert Hooks. Give him a taste of his own medicine.
Well, anyway, I never met the guy, but now, you know, look, that was just a period. It was an interesting period, but my Broadway period.
Well, it wasn't my Broadway period, but a while ago, back east, and I was doing documentary films, and there's a lot of in-between periods that you're not working.
Really?
we know those periods.
And I had a cousin who was in the management for social services, and they said, "Hey, you know, you have a college degree. You know, we're hiring temporary people. Go file for it and make sure you get the job." So I go down there. It was in Brooklyn. I go down there. I make my app. I'm waiting in the room for about 3 hours, and people are coming and going. Finally, they call me in. They say, they look at me and they look at my app. They said, "Did you have a Malcolm Berman that worked at WNEW-TV?" Which I did. They said, I said, "No." "Did they have a Malcolm Berman that went to college with you?" And I said, "No." "Did you have a Malcolm Berman that went to Abraham Lincoln High School?" And I said, "No." They said, "Well, you're working here already." They had somebody
named
Malcolm Berman with my resume.
Spelled,
oh, wow.
With your resume. Different birth date.
Yeah.
And different Social Security code, but my resume.
He stole all of the items
it
from turns your
out, I turns out I finally got to see a picture of him. Turns out a guy that I had met.
Oh, wow.
I had an employment agency. You know, when you go to an employment agency looking for a job, you give them your resume.
Right.
So he took my resume.
Oh, wow.
This is the first part of it. So he left before they could find him. 2 years later, I'm teaching English as a second language. It's called the Welfare Education Plan. I'm living in the Upper West Side. I get a bill in the mail from the police department that my ticket is overdue.
Mm.
I start getting calls from kids saying, "Oh, Mr. Berman, yeah." And they say, "Oh, you're our teacher." Turns out he became a teacher, got a teacher's license.
Wow.
And I went down to the Board of Ed, and it was the same guy.
Same guy.
So yeah. Identity theft is kind of a classic crime, huh?
So
he liked you, Malcolm.
Now, what was funny is when I went to the police station to report it, it was the days of Serpico. And those days in film, I wore my jeans, long hair, stocking hat. I had a beard. I go into wore a fatigue jacket, right? I go into the
precinct. You were a beatnik.
Yeah, I went to the precinct. The guy says, "Upstairs." "Upstairs." I go upstairs. The guy says, "It's the door to the right." I don't know what they're talking about. Turns out they sent me into the narcotic squad. They thought I was undercover.
Narc.
A narc. Anyway, so.
Yeah, those were the days, weren't they?
Yeah. By the way, I understand that you're really not Robert Hooks.
Actually, that's not my name. My real name is Bobby Dean.
Bobby Dean.
Bobby Dean Hooks. My father hated Robert. So he named me Bobby. And at the time, Dizzy Dean was a pitcher for the Washington Senators, and he liked Dizzy Dean, so he gave me a middle name, Bobby Dean, right? And I, through the years, loved my name, right? And when I was a teenager, I was visiting my mother, because I was not a teenager, I was older than that. And I was visiting my mother, and she told me that I said, "Where did Dean, how did I get Dean?" And she told me the story about Dizzy Dean. It turns out Dizzy Dean was a racist. I mean, a serious racist. Really serious racist. And
A serial racist.
And so I wanted to get rid of the Dean. Well, it turns out I ended up getting rid of Bobby Dean anyway, thanks to Roscoe Lee Brown, who told me I should change my name after I did a play in New York called Dutchman. By Leroy Jones, and it was a big, big hit play, and Roscoe and I went to dinner one night afterwards, and he says, "Robert, it's time for you to change your name. You are no longer a Bobby Dean. You're a Robert."
Robert.
Well, Robert.
Now that we're on Robert, I have to ask you a question, and it's always been in the back of my mind, as well as a lot of other people, because you've been in all of the different venues. Which do you prefer, TV, movies, or the Broadway stage?
Well, not Broadway stage, it's stage.
The
because
stage,
it's off Broadway.
And it's also off Broadway.
Exactly, and I've done them all. No, I have to say to you that the actor's medium is not film and television, it's the stage. And I would much prefer to be on the stage, but of course, along came television, along came film, and you got to do it.
And along came money.
But wait a minute. When you're on the stage, you have to know your lines. But when you're on TV or the movies, they could have 100 retakes.
Well, but you still have to know your lines. Sometimes people forget their lines. But when that curtain goes up on the stage...
Sometimes I forget where I live.
But when that curtain goes up on the stage, there's a beginning, a middle, and an end. You got to know your lines because there's no cut. Let's do it again. That's only in film.
Also, when it comes to theater, you own your performance. No one is going to do something unexpected in the editing room. You're not going to act your brains out and find out that it was the other person's close-up that got the footage. When you are on there, the performance is what you meant it to be.
Okay, hold on to the thought. Paul, weren't we doing away with the 45 break? Okay, because we got signal for 45, and we did it so we can continue.
Cool.
We can continue.
So we just ignore him.
Ignore him.
That's a good point.
He made a boo-boo.
Laurie makes a great point.
Well, the thing is, in film and on TV, it's director and editors.
Editors' meeting.
Because they can give you the shot that they want on TV. The perspective is of the director, so he can shoot anything that he wants, which then brings the audience to their focal point.
Right.
But an actor on stage, he controls it.
Oh, yeah. And
I don't know if you've heard of Shirley Clarke. She was a filmmaker that was blazingly independent. She's a classic in independent filmmaking. And I was fortunate enough to be in the one stage piece that she did where she combined video and live action. And it was thrilling to work with her, but she hated doing theater. She said she would never do it again because she said when she did a film, it was frozen in exactly the form she wanted it to be. But, of course, with stage, every night was different,
right,
which was great for us,
yes,
but really crazy making for her.
Great for the actor, you know, improvisation.
You know, this brings to mind the movie, which was first a play, the Osage County, August Osage County.
Right.
Saw the play in Broadway when it came out, and the movie was totally different because, again, the play, everybody's on the stage at the same time, but the movie, they close up and they zero in, and you get a different perspective from the different actors as you go along. And it's almost, wow, it's really different.
Writers hate it. I mean, writers don't like the fact that they can write a screenplay, and then when the film is complete, they don't even recognize it because in the editing room is where a film is made.
Well, and yet also there's always the challenge of taking like with A Raisin in the Sun, of taking a really successful stage piece, a moving, brilliant stage piece, and needing to expand it. And I'm hard-pressed right now without a computer in front of me to think of any examples where they've been equally brilliant. It's a devil of a task.
But, you know, it's even more so in a book. A novelist writes a book, and they don't even want to have their name on the movie because it's been changed so many times over. They're really just retaining the name and maybe the name of the character, but it's a whole different storyline.
I think there are one or two films that I liked that when that if I had read the book before, they loved the book and they did a good interpretation of it.
Well, Laurie reads. I'm sorry.
I know that with. I'm an inveterate
reader. Laurie reads everything. She reads everything. So when we go to see a movie, she's already read the book.
I mean, with Cloud Atlas in particular, I was racing against the clock to finish it before we had to go to the Academy screening. And I was so grateful that I did because the book, its format, its characters, what it says about eternity is so brilliant. And if anyone thought the movie was the book, I just feel sad for them.
So you
sometimes
didn't like the movie?
No.
And I saw the movie and liked the movie because I didn't read the book.
Right, you saw it was a movie unto itself. Yeah, most of the times I am really disappointed if I really love the book and about the movie. The only thing that possibly might be good in film when they have the miniseries. Mm-hmm. And I remember Shogun, which I loved the book and I loved the series. The same thing with Roots.
Mm-hmm. Or
Ruth
backstage
done so
at the
well.
White House.
Or backstage at the White House.
Which was six or eight parts that he had done.
Right, but they have it where you can put in the certain details, mm-hmm. which you can't in mm-hmm. a two-hour
right.
movie.
Exactly.
But to do in a six, seven, 10 hours, you can include it.
It's a shame they stopped doing miniseries. I mean, they still do them occasionally, but I remember when you're talking about those shows, they were doing them all the time.
Yeah.
I was involved in a couple of them. And it's just really nice to be able to have a six or eight part movie. I mean, you know, on television.
It just made me realize.
It gives you more work.
Well, that's true, too. Yeah.
Well, just made me realize something. I love words and the term miniseries. Because now we do have miniseries, but they're series. They're series that are limited-run series. They're 6 to 8 episodes, as opposed to what we used to think were miniseries, which was a saga, a broad story that was cut up in enough parts. I get very literal with words.
Now, Netflix, I was able to see a series. People were telling me about this series, Breaking Bad. Everybody would talk about Breaking Bad. And I thought, geez, you know, I've not seen the show, but I'm going to have to do something. So my son says, well, you know, don't you have Netflix? My son, Kevin. And I said, yeah, you know, I got enough with my own television, cable, whatever. So he came over and he hooked up Netflix for me. I watched 4 seasons or 5 seasons in 2 days.
We did that at our house.
To catch me up on, and it was, I think Breaking Bad was probably one of the greatest series of all time. But I would have missed it had it not been for Netflix.
That's called
when
binge watching.
Are you talking about inventing new words? Binge watching.
And that's what it was.
Quickly you did Game of Thrones.
Well, Game of Thrones is the same thing.
Right. I mean, that was 2.5 days.
I've seen them all, and now I'm hooked. I can't wait. Okay. But now it's a week-to-week
right.
thing.
Mr. Hook, you're hooked. But I have to ask you, have you done Shakespeare?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I was the first black Henry V for the New York Shakespeare Festival under Joe Papp. Under Joe Papp's direction. It was the first black Henry, and it was my only Shakespeare in play. I mean, I've done Shakespeare in workshop and school and all that when I was studying, but yes, I did Henry V.
Do you find Shakespeare a hard language to act as opposed to read? Because I remember it from high school. I didn't take any in college, but I remember in high school, it was difficult for me to read and follow and figure out what the hell are they talking about.
No, it's not. It's not hard at all. Once you learn the iambic pentameter, once you learn how to do it, then you know the language and the characters come alive.
Okay,
so
but you can't
well.
Go by how I was when I was a high school student.
No,
I was dumb and stupid. You have no idea.
Robert, I have a question for you.
Sure.
You talk very eloquently.
Oh, stop! Really?
I'm just as a teenager growing up, did you talk like this, or is it years of classes, or did you always have this? A manner of speaking.
No, I think once I started acting in the theater, and I started acting at a very, very young age, it was almost automatic to learn how to speak, to learn how to deliver lines, to learn how to make sentences work, the music of a sentence, the music of a character.
Do you speak other languages?
No, I don't.
Just the one.
Just this okay. one. But I can fake it. You would think that I'm. If you are not Italian and you don't know Italian,
it's like living
you would
Sid
think
Caesar.
That I was speaking Italian.
You do like Sid Caesar used
yes,
to do.
Yes, exactly.
Really? Can you give us an example?
Hey, well, you man, today you talk in van. Hey, tutta mancante or panata ci siede, ma non posso mentire. Parnalite, cucine.
Robert, you can't say that in TV. Did you bleep that out, Paul?
But the thing is that people don't know anything.
Yeah, that was an F-bomb, Paul, and you missed it.
And, I mean, Italian, but then there are other... But that's just a player. Actors do this all the time. You know.
Are you good with music? Or, as far
well,
as
the last play I did on Broadway was a Broadway musical, and there's an album that I sing on.
Because I think
Sinatra was my favorite, and I think when I sing, I sound like Sinatra.
You sound like Sinatra.
He knows music.
Oh,
yes,
right.
Well, if you got the, if you get the album, if you pick up that album,
Hallelujah Baby,
Hallelujah Baby, with Leslie Uggams.
And there's a clip. Okay. There is a Tony clip from 1977 or 6.
It's on YouTube.
It is him and Leslie, and they are doing one of the signature numbers from Hallelujah Baby, all singing, all dancing.
Can you pick that up on YouTube?
Oh yeah, yeah. Is she still around?
Hallelujah Baby,
Hallelujah Baby.
She was one hell of a singer.
Anyway, Stan, we're coming up to a break.
A break.
You're listening to The View from Over Here, heard on CRN Digital Talk Radio and carried on the World Wide Web at crntalk.com. Be back in a few minutes.
Hi folks, Fred Dreyer for Regenix. Like so many people today, I was losing my hair. I was literally watching it fall out, jumping right off the top of my head. So I said, that's it, enough. I called Regenix. When they introduced me to their patented hair analysis program, I immediately saw why I was losing my hair. Through their microscopic examination, I saw gray, sickly scalp. The hair follicles themselves were caked and clogged with the dirty, oily sludge. I was so relieved. Finally, there was hope. So now, as I approach my 8th year on the Regenix program, my scalp is pink and clean and my hair is growing back. That's right, it's growing back. It makes so much sense. Don't wait. Call Regenix right now. Go to the phone and put an end to your worries. Start by calling 1-800-REGENIX. That's 1-800-REGENIX, or go to Regenix.com.
Hi, this is Sharon Evans.
And Rick Rogers.
Join us for the Evans and Rogers Show, Sunday at 8 p.m. Pacific Time, 11 p.m. Eastern Time.
We'll talk about America's golden age of entertainment and the talented performers of that era.
And its history. That's the Evans and Rogers Show, Sunday night at 8 Pacific, 11 Eastern.
Right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio.
Many things cause memory loss. Have you had a brain health checkup?
I think this is something that's been long overdue.
And often it's covered by insurance. I'm Aileen Ellis. This is Primetime Focus. Dr. Majid Fatoui heads up the Neurex Fan Brain Center in Maryland.
We are a neurology institute dedicated to help people improve their memory.
That process starts with a brain health checkup, several tests, including a written one.
This is a 3-hour test that checks your memory, attention, concentration, speed of processing.
Simple quizzes and brain games.
Then we do something called brain mapping.
An EEG that records brain activity that shows if you have anxiety or depression.
Finally, do a brain MRI, look at brain structure.
Checking the part of the brain that holds our memories, the hippocampus. Tomorrow, medical issues that can cause memory loss. For more info on conditions that mimic dementia, check out the April issue of the AARP Bulletin. That's Primetime Focus, brought to you by AARP. Hear all our programs on the web at aarp.org/radio.
Hi, everyone. This is Robert Conrad reminding you to join me each week on CRN, the PM show with Robert Conrad. We'll read your emails, take your calls, and chat with some of the hottest stars in Hollywood. Tune in Thursday to the PM show with me, Robert Conrad, right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio.
Tune in to the PM show with Robert Conrad, 3 p.m. Pacific Time, 6 p.m. Eastern, right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio.
Are we in our last segment now?
We're in the last segment.
The last go.
The last throws. Anyway, we're back. This is Stan Weisleder and Malcolm Berman, and our special guests today, Robert Hooks and his lovely wife, Lori Marlowe.
But we want to get them as regular contributors to the show.
We were going to spring it on them, okay?
Oh, okay.
All right, so let's spring it on them right now. So we have how many millions of people listening?
We have the ability to reach the immediate world. Not that we necessarily reach them, but we do have the ability to. Anyone that's on the internet can directly go into crntalk.com and get the show live. Mm-hmm. Or, if they're busy at this time, where there could be, though this time would be, it's 11 o'clock, would be 2 o'clock New York time. What time would it be in London?
8 hours plus.
5:55.
Right, 5:55, and then they could get it in China, any place that you have friends. Okay. But if they happen to miss it, they could go to www.viewfromoverhere.com.
Also, don't forget, Malcolm, this is replayed on Saturday.
Oh, okay.
And on Sunday. Saturday, 1 o'clock California time. And Saturday, 1 o'clock California time. And on Sunday, 5 p.m. California time, which is 3 hours later in New York.
So when you're speaking to the mic, do I have to tell you to
the
that
mic?
Also?
I'm talking to our guests.
Now, Mike's not here. That's Mike.
Okay. Anyway.
I don't understand. Right. How long have you been doing this?
And he's the host.
Too long.
And he's the host.
Long. The host with the most. Anyway.
I think he's so enthralled with you guys and talking. Yes.
Well, look.
He thinks nobody's...
I want you guys to be regulars on the show. I like you. And we want to get your feedback about the entertainment industry. I think you guys have a unique perspective.
So how would it manifest on your show?
Well, I would let our producer here... work it out with you and...
No, I mean, you have an hour.
We would talk about... You would come on in and we'd introduce you for a 10-minute segment or so. We would go ask you questions. What did you want to talk about today?
Sure.
You might want to do it each week. You might want to do it like, twice a month. I don't know.
No, Laurie and I would love to do something like that. That's an excellent idea.
Yeah. To me, a show is something that grows. I have an idea of what I want the show to be about, but something comes into the show and we change it. If it doesn't, it dies.
Like, for instance, let's say you guys are in the business and you see a particular movie. You get invite, you see all these Academy showings, and you may say, well, okay, I saw XYZ movie.
Sure.
I liked it. It stunk. Whatever, okay?
Yeah.
And you can list your reasons. It's good because, or it stunk because. And
I can't do that because I vote, so...
Do you vote, Laurie?
No, she doesn't.
No,
vote.
I mean, we'll be talking about movies when the context of them, like a Django, is larger, when the societal impact.
But I'm wondering,
is it all right for me to solicit, to give two contact venues if people have something they would actually like to hear us
review or to talk
or,
about?
Or treat, you know, that's in media.
Absolutely.
I mean, if anyone would like to suggest any topics they would like to hear, you can reach Robert directly on his Facebook page, Robert Hooks /Cultural Architect.
Well, we're going to have everything on our website.
Oh, okay, great.
So you
great.
Go to www.viewfromoverhere.com.
Okay,
we will have your bios on there, your pictures.
Yeah, because we would love to hear what people would like
to
hear.
Where you live and your personal phone number.
And then the last four
and your social
are
security number
anyway, guys,
and everything.
We reach the end of the show. Thank you very much for being our guest.
It's a pleasure.
Joining us for future shows. You're listening to The View From Over Here on CRN Digital Talk Radio and carried on the World Wide Web at crntalk.com. And you can listen to us at www.viewfromoverhere.com. Bye. I'm getting a wrap.
The View From Over Here is a co-production of Infinity X and TBG International. For further information, contact Malcolm Berman at 818-687-2784. That's 818-687-2784.
Which was most appropriate because that was your theme.
Are you tired of hearing your favorite talk radio show sound like this? What if you could hear your favorite shows in crystal clear, high-definition digital sound? Well, with CRN Digital Talk Radio's 6 channels of high-definition radio, you can now hear all of your favorite hosts like you've never heard them before in CRN HD. The difference is amazing. Catch your favorite political hosts like Dennis Prager, Tom Hartman, Barry Farber, and so many more. Entertainment and lifestyle programming like The Robert Conrad Show, The What's Cooking Show, and The What's Cooking on Wine Show, all in true CRN HD audio. Sports, business, travel, food, wine, politics, there is something for everyone, and it's all available in CRN High Definition Sound. Log on to www.crntalk for listings and information on all your favorite shows. That's www.crntalk.com.
The Radio Channel.
Try Fry Vineyards, the Mendocino County organic wine with no sulfites added from America's pioneering organic winery. Fry Wine, the first maker of certified biodynamic wines in the United States. At Fry Wines, our emphasis is on producing organic wine of the highest quality while caring for our planet and palate alike. Check out our website at frywine.com and join the Fry Vineyards Wine Club. You'll receive 20% off all orders and much more. Plus, you can check out our internet-only specials. And go to our crntalk.com website or the frywine.com website and check out Chef Piero's Recipe of the Week. Great biodynamic wines from Redwood Valley in Mendocino County, California. Fry Wines. Go to frywine.com. That's F-R-E-Y-W-I-N-E, frywine.com. Check it out and enjoy great wines at your home tonight.
How deep in debt are you? $10,000? $15,000? Maybe even more? And every day that goes by, you know what happens. Your debt gets larger and larger and larger. Well, if you've had it with your mushrooming debt problem and the stress it is causing you, make this free call today to the Debt Solutions Network. One quick no-obligation call is all it takes for one of our partner companies to show you how they can help you get out of debt. So if you have $10,000 or more in combined debt and you want to learn how you can solve it, make this free, no-obligation call now.
800-814-5108. 800-814-5108.
If you are in serious debt, you have to get out of it and fast. Call my friends at the Debt Solutions Network now.
800-814-5108. 800-814-5108. Call us 24/7. 800-814-5108.
Memory loss.
We need to find a cause and then treat the underlying cause. Just like if you have chest pain, you go see a doctor.
For memory issues, go to a brain specialist. I'm Aileen Ellis. This is Primetime Focus.
In elderly people, especially women, a urinary tract infection can cause memory loss and confusion without necessarily causing burning with urination or other typical signs and symptoms of a UTI.
Dr. Majeev Fatui heads up the NeuroExpand Brain Center in Maryland.
Before I jump into the consideration of Alzheimer's disease, I'll check a urine analysis. And if the urine is a problem, once you treat it, you go back to the same level of cognitive function they were before.
Other things that can cause memory loss include low levels of B12, diabetes, and thyroid issues. Get more details about conditions that mimic dementia in the April issue of the AARP Bulletin. Tomorrow, wine, fish oil, and memory. That's Primetime Focus, brought to you by AARP. Hear all our programs on the web at aarp.org/radio.
Those of you listening to the last hour of the show, happy Earth Day to everybody out there, whether the sun is shining or not. Well, we just had a little sun break happen out here, so it is a shiny day. Shiny day. I like that. Not a sunny day anymore. We're now going to have a shiny day. Why? Because we're going to shed light on the situation from your heart and recalibrate with Truth Is Funny host. And Truth Is Funny, amazing facilitator. Well, yeah, my friend, my colleague, Colette Steffen, joining me here today. Shed some light on it. That's what we're going to do. We're going to shine. Going to make it all shiny. Going to be so you can't really not do it. And that's what we love about today. So today, you know, we look at life and we think about the what if. What, you know, what if? What if this? What is that? You know, is this complicated in life? How do we go about things in our lives? Well, you know, here's what you're going to know. If you've ever tuned into the hit radio show, Truth Is Funny, one of the things you're going to find is that you are going to be sitting on the edge of your seat. You're going to be in awe. And then when those phone lines open, as you know they do, and you call in to have this amazing healer, individual, take a look at what's going on in your life and shift some energy, then you know you have arrived. She's joining me here today as someone that has been so well trained, and you're going to hear about that, someone that has said yes to the intuition that is her birthright, and she has created a phenomenal radio program, which many of you already know about. But most importantly, what you should know is she shows up in the world to help all of you. That's what you got to love about her. That's what we know about her. And that's what, for many of us, absolutely love to connect with. You can go to the truthisfunny.com website, check it out. You're going to be able to find out about who she is. But guess what? It's going to be fun. We're going to have a fun time here. We're going to be able to talk about some of the things that get in our way so that we can clear them out. And for those of you out there that do not have the phone number, if you want to call in for this show and get some help, get some things to move, give us a shout, 1-800-930-2800.